Time to wake up. The new dispensation is here now. It is a new dispensation, a new chapter, in our awakening. This new chapter has a goal of abiding in non-dual truth. Abiding in non-dual truth. This seems to be like a lofty goal, but we have a way to attain it. The practice we have, full stop in the wow, is the key practice that we need to attain abidance in non-dual truth, as opposed to previously, in the previous chapter, we glimpsed it. Okay. We had glimpses. But in this chapter, we now abide in it. Okay, and we've had some precursors that who have already done this and have shown us that it's possible. Of course, Jesus is one of those, but we have some precursors that were just very recent, which helps us out a lot. A very famous one is, you'll recognize this face, this countenance, this presence here. And these precursors are very, very helpful for us. Very, very helpful for us. So they point out, yes, you can. Yes, we can. Yes, we can. And now we have the tools to do this. We're most certainly going to do it. Most certainly. I feel for sure I'm going to do this. That's Ramana Maharshi, and he has this wonderful abidance in non-dual truth. Completely steady in it. No wavering at all. No wavering at all. So right now, this chapter seems to be kind of blank. But we do have the Good Shepherd, who is going to shepherd us into this new dispensation. And we're going to be able to succeed at this. And we're going to be able to abide in non-dual truth. I feel very strongly that this is going to take place. So, starting the new chapter out, we start to read this chapter, both through our practice, through our focus, through our determination, through our dedication. And we find that we're making very rapid progress right now, which is a very good thing, because the play of arrogance in this world is becoming so extraordinary that it's jaw-dropping extraordinary. And this is what I pointed out. I pointed out in starting in January of 2016, we're on this what is it, 18-month effort, something like, January, February, March, April, May, June, which would be 17 months, 18 months. We want to be finished by June 21st, 2016. We want to be abiding in non-dual truth by that time. And I feel it's a very reachable objective. And I said that if we're not abiding in it, then we're going to likely be swept away in the arrogance of the times, the play of arrogance, which is what existence is, play of arrogance. And we need not be reacting too much to the operatives here in this world, the big shots who seem to be changing everything so fast, because they're just the underlings of actually cosmic corporate culture, which is a consortium of various extraterrestrial groups. But these extraterrestrial groups are actually just the underlings of the logic of arrogance. The logic of arrogance is the puppet master. And the logic of arrogance is an underling to what? Spiritual arrogance. Spiritual arrogance. And spiritual arrogance it comes from what? From spirit wanting to be greater than God. From the idea of wanting to be greater than God. That's where it ultimately comes from. So all this whole situation we have is a spiritual problem. So it has to be solved spiritually. So we need the Good Shepherd at this point. We absolutely need the Good Shepherd to shepherd us into this new chapter, new dispensation. and free us from this chain of arrogance, actually, chain of arrogance that we are facing right now in this world. I mean, it is really astonishing what is happening, and it's certainly playing out the way that the conspiracy people, whatever you want to call them, the prophets, the visionaries, has said it will play out. They've been absolutely right. And what I have long said is that there is an intentional attempt to bring about chaos on this planet. It's a scripted, willful, purposeful intent to bring about chaos on this planet so that then we will be desperate to invite help here. And that help will present itself as this cosmic corporate culture, and they will come on in here and then say well, you asked us to come here, so don't criticize us, welcome us, be positive towards us, you know, allow us to, you know, do our thing here, so we can you know, prove that we're here to help you. So it's basically the ones that want to take over, bring about a crisis that then seems to that seems to call out for their assistance. This is how they work. Very clever. Not that clever though. I mean, it's pretty simple stuff. So it's very important that when you see the actions of leaders and people here in this world, there's a couple of them, the most famous two, of course, are the Pope and the President of the United States. Those are the ones that are really front and center on the stage. There's a couple of leading actors on the stage right now. So when you see their acting, it's very important not to really react to it, not to pay any attention to it, really. Because there's a whole chain here, right? There's an entire chain of arrogance taking place here, designed to produce chaos on this planet and to create a climate where people are just desperate for some sort of sanity to enter the picture, some sort of organization, something that has an answer that is a departure from what's going on here. So when you see these various chess moves that are being made, and they're certainly being made, some extraordinary chess moves, daily, actually, and you question the sanity of these people, the leaders, and you say, what are you doing? This is absolutely crazy. Well, they are actually simply operatives in a script that is taking place here. So don't even, you know, just look at them as inconsequential. The important thing is to not get fooled by this script. Don't get fooled by it. Continue to insist that all problems are spiritual problems. It's a spiritual problem of arrogance. That's the root of all our problems, is our own arrogance, attempt to be greater than God. So it has to be solved in a spiritual way. All this name calling of these people, and yelling and ranting and that doesn't help the situation. Actually, we have to realize that our arrogance, as it logic of it plays out, has played out through various entities, and these entities we would relate to them from our standpoint as extraterrestrials. They're very clever at what they do. Okay, so ranting and raving at their underlings here, who are, you know, just a petty bourgeois officials, really, from their standpoint, the big wigs that we look, think, and say, wow, these are the most powerful people in the world. These people are just very petty bourgeois operatives here, from a bigger standpoint. Very minor bit players. Well, it's very important for us to not get caught up in railing against them. We can recognize what they're doing and just say, wow, For sure, it's a huge wow. I mean, it is audacity on an incredible scale, really. But if you look back through history, this is not unprecedented. For instance, in ancient Egypt, there was this pharaoh called Akhenaten, something like that. And he came into this priestly religious system of Egypt, and he basically threw it all out and said, no, we're going to worship the sun exclusively, the solar sun. We have this monotheistic sun worship. And he took all the power away from the priesthood and set himself up as the divine king. And it just was astonishing what a departure from what Egypt was used to. And then finally, when Akhenaten departed here, very quickly, I think wasn't King Tut the son of Akhenaten or something, but very quickly the priests reestablished power and the traditional religion came back. They just said, wow, we don't like this guy at all. But he was able to, it's astonishing the power he was able to wield there. I mean, I'm sure the Egyptians were thinking, there's no way in the world anything like this could happen. And yet it did. So this Akhenaten, I can't even look that up. Am I online or anything? Maybe not. Nope. Had an extraordinary ability to, some might say, subvert an entire culture against the wishes of the people. And do it anyway. So just with a tremendous arrogance. The arrogance of Akhenaten was extraordinary. So it is possible. Another person such as like Adolf Hitler was possible to subvert an entire country and plunge the world into war. And we wonder how in the world could very intelligent people like the Germans get pushed down that road. So it's extraordinary what certain personality types who have sort of an overriding potent arrogance, how they can seem to subdue, override and subdue, even to the point of fundamentally changing an entire civilization, an entire tradition. Now, Egypt had a very long tradition. How in the world could someone come along and turn that on its head? Just tremendous, tremendous, tremendous arrogance. So, this happens. We have examples throughout history of this kind of sort of the charisma of arrogance, you might call it. There is a certain charisma of arrogance that is able to just sort of hold people spellbound and think that there's nothing they can do about the situation. They have to go along with it. And maybe it's all for the best, and they rationalize it. So we have a situation like that here now in this world. Like a pharaonic situation. That's for sure. Akhenaten-like situation. And it hasn't quite reached its apex yet. It's slid into mediocrity. So, a little fatigued here. It catches up with me because this is so stressful to push all this information out to the world. So we have a similar situation right now in the world where civilization is being subverted to an extraordinary extent. One of the ways that this is most obvious and most shocking, and it should get everybody saying, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh, is the really blatant attempt to push out local policing, okay, to push it and replace it ultimately with federal policing, perhaps with the military. This is just the most extraordinarily drastic, shocking thing. I think that if if, for instance, when I was young, I was aware that the world was going to go this way, and I tried to warn people, and I said, hey, you wait and see, you know, and they said I was a kook, you know, a kook. Because if you told people back then that local police would be federalized and they'd be pushed out, you know, they would say, you're absolutely crazy. That is the most ridiculous thing that can never happen in America. No way is it possible. This is where we're going. This is the steps, the chess steps that are being taken here. There's a very important reason for that. Has to do with generating turmoil and chaos here, and then ultimately clamping down on the population and introducing a new structure, which is the structure of the extraterrestrials. Local policing is way better. And so they're trying to demonize local policing. It's a calculated program, chess moves that are being taken place here. And of course, it's completely naked and transparent to those who are not just complete party ideologues. And bear in mind that it's very good to be like an independent, politically independent, which is what I am. And so I can see anything. My attention can see. I'm not beholden to any party at all. I don't donate or support either any party. I'm completely independent. So I can notice from all the whole spectrum, I can just look and see without anything telling me, hey, better not look there. That might make your party look bad, you know. Don't have any of that. So it's an enormous advantage to be, you know, independent, politically independent, socially independent. Be independent of that. Not be stuck in some, like having to defend some party, because then you become blind, you become a fool. You know, you become an operative running interference for what the party is doing. Even though it might be very, very nefarious activity, you still feel, you know, that you have to be a good loyal partyist and still run interference for it, which is just, you know, really pathetic. And there's so many people doing that right now. On the internet, there's a constant back and forth of party operatives just simply running interference one way or the other, and not employing any reason or not even seeing what's happening in any way. So, but what's really the design, what's happening here, is the working out of the design that the extraterrestrials have, this cosmic corporate culture. Consortium of various extraterrestrial groups have a design, a purpose for this planet that they want to carry out, that they think benefits them, that helps them win. So really, it's how to overcome that. It's how to overcome that is the problem. And so we really need a spiritual solution. Not a political solution. A spiritual solution is what we need. This what we're facing is not really politics. It's not really politics. It's spiritual arrogance. What we're really facing is just the logic of spiritual arrogance as it plays out in its very unwelcome ways. It's very nasty, always has been. Full of shocking chess moves that we say, how could that possibly take place here? And if we're a party operative, you know, we'll just ignore it and say, well, my party's right no matter what happens. And it'll just go along like a, you know, like a lemming. And all of the propaganda will seem so good to you. You'll say, oh, yeah, that's right. But when you drop any party affiliation, then you start to think for yourself and to look for yourself. And then you see what's going on, and you just say, hey, wait a minute. This isn't what I signed up for. This isn't right. This isn't good. But keep in mind, it's a spiritual problem we're dealing with. The problem of... What's that? Spiritual arrogance. the problem of someone over there, I don't know, seemed to be problem of spiritual arrogance. And how do we something's hanging out somewhere here that making noise. How do we combat this? What do we do about it? This is where our spiritual practice comes into play. It sounds like there's somebody rummaging around, but this is where our spiritual practice comes into play, okay? And it's essential during this new dispensation now, and I'll dial that up. It's essential that we engage in spiritual practice right now, right spiritual practice. And we do it with right guidance, and we really get after it, and we recognize this is the remedy to the situation. We have to trump, as it were, the whole logic of arrogance and how it plays out through this cosmic corporate culture. So we're not dealing just with human pressures now. We're dealing with cosmic corporate culture, cosmic pressures. This is something that was pointed out by St. Paul, I believe, maybe some of his letters that he wrote to the churches, early churches. He said, we struggle not against powers and principalities of this world, but powers and principalities in the heavens on high, high levels. Which he's speaking of extraterrestrials, actually speaking of cosmic corporate culture. That's where the struggle is. And the only way to overcome that is repentance, which is to set our arrogance down so that we can see clearly. We can see, and ultimately we can abide in non-dual awareness, abide in non-dual truth. And from this, we realize, we truly realize and see God. We actually see God exactly as God is. And we realize that there is no finish line whatsoever. There is no finish line. There is no race. There is no contest. There is no winning, there is no losing. Just as we are, God is present, just as we are. God is present, absolutely present, right here, right now, everywhere, right here, right now. There is no race, there's no finish line, no race, no contest, no winning, no losing. So this is how we have to deal with what's taking place in this world, which is an intentional effort to drag this world down into a very unstable situation, very dangerously unstable situation, so much so that We're desperate for help. Now, it may be, it's a possibility that part of all of this attempt to federalize the policing of a country is so that the top-down governance can clamp down on the entire country easily. Whereas the police might be very sympathetic to the local people and say, hey, wait a minute, you see what I'm saying? They can bring in police from other countries to clamp down on the population of the country, whereas the local police have friends, they have family, they have a community, they're part of the community, they live there, so they're liable to listen to the people, much more liable to listen to the people, actually. It's quite possible that sometime in the near future, there may be announcements that of extraterrestrial beings. This is what that's been pointing towards, and they want to be sure that civil unrest doesn't happen, because this rollout that will happen here might make people become very well. For instance, in ancient Judea, there was all it was enough just to, I mean, the Jews had these purity laws, and it was enough for some foreign potent or Roman rule or something to just violate these purity laws in some small way, even just for the Jews to become absolutely incensed and actually start plotting revolution and revolt. And so they really had to clamp down on them. So it's possible that people could become quite disturbed by such an announcement, and so they want to be able to somehow clamp down on everywhere and keep civil, you know, order. This is part of it. There's a number of aspects to it. So we're facing these chess moves that I think have any intelligent person saying, "This things aren't going the way that I don't think they're going in a good direction." Have to be very, very suspicious of the chess moves that are taking place. It seems to be being done with a very, very intense hidden ideological agenda behind it. You can feel it. The kind of moves that someone would make if they have some secret hidden agenda that they're trying to steer us to, and they don't want to tell us what it is. You know, just bizarre governance that's taking place right now. Both in from the Pope and from the U.S. President. Bizarre. And so I think everybody's scratching their heads and saying, you know, what is going on? Well, we are being prepared. The situation is being prepared. And so it's perfect time for this new dispensation in the ministry of the Spirit of Truth, Jesus Christ, Spirit of Truth, to bring a new chapter in where we are able to now focus on this abidance and non-dual truth reality and realize we're absolutely free, we're absolutely sovereign. There is no race. I've never been engaged in any race at all, as a matter of fact. And of course we will laugh at that point, seeing that God never was in any race. We're never in a race with God. We'll have a good laugh at that and just say, wow. Wow, there was no race. There's no contest at all. There's no winning, there's no losing. Everything's perfect. This trumps the extraterrestrials. You see, we cannot continue to employ what we think might trump leaders here in this world, the leaders of this world, those politicians' dice, because really, they're just, you know, most politicians are just lawyers, for goodness sakes, which is, they have sort of the most venal type of thinking mindset of almost anyone in the world. Not all lawyers, but a lot of them. Now, there's some very good lawyers, but of course, but often the ones that go into politics have this sort of, you know, very, very specious, casuistic type of manipulating facts, painting pictures that aren't true. You know, like here's how we get the defendant off. We completely distort things, misdirect things, try to make things relative. You know, aren't relative. Just use every trick in the book to confuse, to mislead. You know, to try to get the verdict that they want, and thinking that they can somehow manipulate the human psychology, human reasoning. They're very clever at manipulating other people so they get the outcome they want for themselves. But, of course, this has its limits. When you run across someone who's genuinely aware and intelligent, it doesn't work at all. It's just, it's silly, it's folly. It's exposed as the, you know, the kind of base, gross cleverness that it is. And so they don't really want anyone being smart here in this world. That is for sure. So these lawyerish types think that they're, you know, pulling the wool over everybody's eyes, but they're not. They're not at all. And yet we have to realize that they aren't really the trouble, because we can handle lawyers. I mean, you know, there's no problem actually. Put them in their place. We didn't used to have any trouble with that. Remember, it's only been very recently that lawyers have been able to advertise at all, because they were held in such low regard socially. And now we have all these ambulance chasers ceaselessly advertising and sponsoring all sorts of programs. But if it was just these politician lawyers that was the problem, we'd be able to get that situation right. It's not a problem. So it's something else going on behind the scenes, behind them, which is this cosmic corporate culture. And these are ETs. Now, I have had conversations with ETs. I've certainly observed them, been aware of them. And again, there's all different types, but they're much more clever than the politicians here. Actually, politicians here are really just second rate cleverness, or third rate cleverness, actually. But just so you're dealing with a I would say a more potent strain of arrogance when you deal with the ETs. So much so that they would dismiss me, arrogantly dismiss me, as if their word were somehow law, some sort of cosmic law, and that I had no choice but to follow it and be dismissed. And they weren't very pleased when I would just say, well, you know, I'm not dismissed. I haven't dismissed myself, so I think I'll just stay right with it here. And it's like, shock, you know, what are you talking about? Our word is law to you. Our word is law to you. That's arrogance. So how do you deal with this sort of intense arrogance? This is the trouble we're having here. This is the real trouble that we're having. So we need to get to the point where we're able to dismiss this cosmic arrogance. Cosmic arrogance of the cosmic corporate collective, cosmic corporate culture. We have to be able to dismiss this. So this is why we need this spiritual practice. It's very advanced. It has to be advanced in order to deal with this cosmic problem that we have here. That is taking place here because of some that are very practiced in this, very skillful, very inventive, very practiced, have been waiting for a long time, are willing to wait even longer. They just hope it's not too much misery. That's what they hope. Feeling very exhausted here, so it's not easy to keep consciousness at this level of the new dispensation yet, you see. I'm going in and out of it, sort of, and then I have to bring myself back to it. That was an example right there. I'd almost lost consciousness for a moment. Wow. So again, we were talking about how Do not react to the arrogance that's playing out on this planet as if it's solely the work of these leaders, and it's not. They're just actors and actresses following a script that the ETs are scripting for them, and the ETs are actually following a script that arrogance is scripting for them. The logic of arrogance is scripting for them, and so we have to be able to deal with it at this very deep level. And this is what this new dispensation encourages us to do. This has to be solved there, so we can dismiss arrogance at its root, at its root. And I've certainly been trying to do that, trying to get the will to do that. But it's really important that people of this world realize what's going on, that they are basically under, you might say, attack or by cosmic corporate culture, extraterrestrials. Cosmic corporate culture is engaged in a hostile takeover of this planet. And it sounds like science fiction, but it's actually what is happening right now. Science fiction often had some roots of truth to it, actually. It was rooted in truth in some ways. So oftentimes people recapitulating experiences they've had in other places, other times and places, and then in ways of warning us that this is going to take place here too. And it certainly has. So our techniques and our practice and our help is extraordinary, because it's an extraordinary situation. This situation we're in now is unprecedented here on this planet. We're in an unprecedented situation, and it certainly is deserving of the stewardship and help and mission of Jesus here. It's risen to that intensity, that level of importance. If we keep in mind that Jesus came just before the Second Temple of Jerusalem was Solomon's Temple, the Second Temple was destroyed by, what was it, Titus, by the Roman general, and he, in the Mount of Olives, he wept over Jerusalem, wept over, and he said quite a couple of statements about Jerusalem that indicated, you know, just wow, you're really, you know, this is nobody. He says, I have to go to Jerusalem to die. This is where, you know, nobody dies. None of the saints and prophets die except in Jerusalem. That's where they kill all the saints. And then he's weeping over Jerusalem and telling that, hey, there won't be one stone left on another here, and told everyone that there's a very bad situation coming for Jerusalem and for Judea. Some people call it Judea. Some people call it Judea. Just a matter of pronunciation. So we thought, well, that's, and it happened, you know. And then basically all of Judea got just, you know, the Jews got wiped out and driven out. There was hardly anything left after ultimately the final Bar Kokhba revolt, and later on, 127, 137, something like that, around there. So Jesus saw what was going to happen, and his mission helped the world with this, helped the world with this. Because the Jews took their religion very seriously. They're very dedicated. And somehow what happened in the world then was significant enough for Jesus to start his mission. Now, right now, it's way, way more significant time. It's the most significant time in history right now. Right now. May 2015 it's the most significant time in history that there's ever been here, because really the situation here now is one where this world is literally deciding what the long-term destiny is going to be of those here, and it has to do with really artificial intelligence. It has to do with being taken over by a high-tech extraterrestrial dominating sort of culture that will drive us in a certain direction that is really opposite of the kind of spiritual realization and discipline that we need. So this is a take. This is a takeover. Not Rome coming in and wiping out, you know, Jerusalem and Judea, but extraterrestrials coming in and taking over this planet. This is a way, way bigger situation. Basically, making it mandatory that everybody go along with this technological artificial intelligence future. It's already almost that way. You know, you go across a bridge, you don't even pay a toll. I mean, if you don't, you have to go online. For instance, the Golden Gate Bridge, you have to go online and get a sign up and pay through a credit card for like a month pass or no, one trip over the bridge within a month's time in order to go through. Or if you go through, they just take a picture of your license plate and then send it to you. Then you have to send them a check. You know, it's just amazing how we're going towards a cashless society, actually, and how bad that actually is. There's nothing better than having just good old cash in your pocket and everyone accepting good old cash in your pocket, because you know, the government really cannot interfere. Artificial intelligence can't really interfere. You know, you're free to do whatever you want to do if you have cash, right? And so trying to turn this into a cashless society, just like they're trying to turn it into a driverless society, is very important for this mindset that is at work here. So, artificial intelligence, we are going rapidly into a destiny of being intricately woven into the fabric of artificial intelligence. There'll be a symbiotic relationship, a very strong symbiotic relationship. And so this is such a drastic departure from what we need to do spiritually that you could call it a massive planetary crisis, actually. Massive planetary crisis. It is a planet in crisis right now. Like never before. Before, we have an area of the world was in crisis here and there, but we have an entire planet in severe crisis right now. So it is an extraordinarily important time to have right spiritual guidance. Extraordinarily important time. So this is why Jesus has come back to this planet, because now is the time. This is the end of the age, the end of the cycle, and many don't want to continue their destiny along the grounds the way the world is going with artificial intelligence, materialism, and guilt and slavery and idolatry and all, the whole nine yards of all the troubles. We don't want to go along with that. So it's the perfect time to for Jesus to come back with a new dispensation, a new phase to his ministry. And as we said, this new phase requires us to overcome the arrogance of extraterrestrials. The arrogance we're struggling against is not just the arrogance of human beings on planet Earth. It is the arrogance of a collective of different extraterrestrial groups throughout the cosmos. That is the arrogance we're dealing with. Now you can say, wow, that is just too heavy. Well, it's heavy for sure, but I wouldn't say it's too heavy, because we have the tools. We have the practice of full stop in the wow. We have the full stop in the wow practice that enables us to even dismiss the arrogance of extraterrestrials. Which is ultimately what's necessary here. And And since the people that the extraterrestrials have co-opted, they weren't able to say no. They believe that nobody can say no. That so this is a kind of a historic mission where it has to take place this way. That we're not able to stop this hostile takeover. We're not able to stop artificial intelligence taking over. So this is an extreme crisis, because the old ways are rapidly diminishing. You know, a cashless society is likely to prevail. And with a cashless society comes a tremendous lack of freedom. Tremendous lack of freedom. Every purchase can then easily be routed through a central bureaucracy, and you can be monitored 24/7. It used to be that people had checkbooks and cash in their wallet, bank accounts, and they would, you know, if they wanted a certain situation to turn out a certain way, they'd bribe and they'd do whatever it takes to go. I would do whatever it takes. I'm slipping in and out of consciousness almost right now, so it's hard to keep up a steady talk. I'm not sure if what I've been saying has been making sense, but I think the general tone you can follow that we're in a severe crisis right now, and it's essential that we get the right help right now. So do not be surprised that Jesus is back. Do not be surprised about that. Absolutely, there's no reason to be surprised. These are the times that 100% call out for it. The times that call out for this sort of ministry, for this new dispensation. It is the time of the utmost crisis here in this world. And the crisis is getting worse every day. So there is no more time to waste, actually. It got started, I think, pretty much start with the beginning of May, this new dispensation. Maybe just a little bit before, because May has just been, we realize now that the chess game is now, they're not wasting any time, moving pieces very fast. And it's kind of like there's no more even, they're not even bothering trying to pretend that they're not doing anything other than trying to checkmate us here. You know, there's a drive towards checkmate. That's what's taking place. So we have to checkmate the checkmaters. Checkmate them before they checkmate us. And we do this checkmate, it's a spiritual checkmate, which is we abide in non-dual truth. Now, I pointed out that sun is what hit me, so let me go back to these pictures. Pointed out that there have been these precursors in the world who were abiding in non-dual truth. And at the time, when we were relating to these various examples, we thought, you know, we said, wow, these people are just like the rarest of the rare, the most incredible of the most incredible. But I have to tell you that I never felt that way. I said, well, they're great, that's wonderful. But I didn't feel like, you know, this is like super rare, it hardly ever happens, you know, we can't do that. I never felt that way at all. I said, oh, great, here's a good example of what we're going to do. I look at Ramana Maharshi and I say, oh, this is a great example of how I'm going to be, how you're going to be, how we're going to be in this new dispensation. That's how I always looked at it that way. I was not intimidated the way most people. I didn't react the way most people react. I just said, oh, great, 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 wonderful example of what we're going to be like. So I absolutely believe we are going to succeed at this. The option of not succeeding is actually so terrible, we don't even want to think about that. We want to just go as fast as possible. So when we do start succeeding, it shouldn't be a big surprise at all. I won't be surprised for myself, not at all. Why should I be surprised? I've been working at it my entire life. And these teachers, these examples have told us that you definitely can do it. Yes, we can do this. So no, it's not much of a surprise. This is expected. This is expected at this time, that this is what we will, those who have worked at it, will be able to do, checkmate the situation at its very root. And we'll take it from there. But what's important is that we, more and more, we feel normal about it and say, oh yeah, of course. This isn't anything that is extremely rare, or just some once every 1,000 years or something, and it's just that kind of thing. No, it's something that is necessary right now, and that we can do if we put our mind to it. And so the more that we start keep focusing on this, the better we will feel like at ease and at comfort with this goal, and take it for granted that, yes, of course, this is our goal. How could it be anything else? I mean, do you really think that we're going to succumb to the black hole of artificial intelligence? Does anyone really seriously believe that we're just going to succumb to that? That's nonsense. Do you think those who have been following the grace of God are going to succumb to the black hole of artificial intelligence? No, absolutely not. It's silly to think they would. Absolutely silly. As if we don't have any options. You know, how silly can that possibly be? I hear these bellowers who, are decrying the problems of the world, these zealots, and they say, this is awful, this is terrible, can you believe what's happening? And the worst thing of all is that there's nothing we can do about it. That's terrible. There's nothing we can do about it. What can we do? Everything we try, nothing works. And they go on and on, like, oh my gosh, what do you mean? What a terrible message to say there's nothing that we can do. They're just helping the situation out, the bad situation out, by saying, oh, it's terrible, but there's nothing we can do. So their real message is there's nothing that we can do. So they're really helping it along under the guise of attacking it. See, this is what I've noticed, that there's been a lot of attacking of the situation that's going on in the world. A lot of people say, how terrible. And then they say, oh my gosh, there's nothing we can do about it. That's the worst thing of all about it at all. They're really part of the problem. Because they get you all fired up thinking, I got to do something about this. It's so terrible, and they're so worried, and then they drop the terrible news on you, but there's nothing we can do about it, which demoralizes you, very much demoralizes you, and gets you in a very reactive, antagonistic mood, which helps give excuses for, a heavy hand from above. And that's what they want. That's what this whole situation is about. So they're really just playing along with the cosmic corporate culture, but under the guise of attacking it. Whereas here it's very, very different. We absolutely have a remedy. We have been following this remedy. We've been preparing for this remedy. We are completely confident that we will succeed in this remedy. So we don't need to bemoan our fate at all. We don't need to just sit there and bemoan our fate and say there's nothing we can do. We've been totally scam, this is so completely terrible, ain't it awful, there's nothing we can do, we're just completely stuck in this thing, how did this happen, just all this kind of moaning and wailing and gnashing of teeth. They're actually, again, that's a disguise for the fact that they're actually promoting what it is they claim to be upset about. They're actually promoting it, undermining our morale and our spirit. But what we do here is we say there is a way to get free of this. There absolutely is a way, and we will absolutely do this. Just like Ramana Maharshi did it. He absolutely did it. And, so this has been a very tough video to make. I am drifting in and out of, I'm barely conscious actually. It's very tough. So this is a great example of struggling against the pressure. That sometimes you have to stagger along. And that's what I've been doing here, staggering along. I keep picking up the thread, but I'm like hardly awake to, and at any moment I'll drop it. You know, I feel so tired and listless, and my consciousness is having problems expressing itself here. So we have to abide in non-dual awareness, a non-dual truth. This is just something that we need to do, have to do to keep up with the times, actually. We're just keeping up with the times in doing this. This is true. This is really true. This is just kind of like, you know, going and getting yourself some clothes that are that's the in fashion right now. That's all. It's like that. We just have to be fashionable, keep up with fashion, and being rightly fashionable at this time is non-dual abidance, actually. That's having the right fashion for the times. Not having that is really being out of style, out of fashion. Very difficult to keep going here. Just getting hammered by severe fatigue. I didn't sleep much last night. That has something to do with it, because the wow from the video I did that last night was so strong. I knew it would be. This is the idea that we believe we're in a race with God, and we're doing trying all these tricks on God to get God to slow down, to get God to stop paying attention, so that we can win the race. I'm just gonna bump up the sun has gone down here, and. This was so stunning to see all this, to see the play of arrogance, you know, in your own life, in the life of this world, how it plays out, to see it and recognize it and understand this, what it is. I mean, I've seen it before, but I didn't know what it was. It was just some thoughts. I didn't understand, well, you know, why am I having those thoughts? I don't know. But to now recognize what those thoughts, the purpose those thoughts are serving, and to see, you know, to see the folly of it, it's like, that is just so extraordinary. So I couldn't sleep very well. My was just humming. It was just earth shaking sort of clarity. So that has partly to do with I'm feeling, you know, very very hard time keeping my consciousness awake. But just like if you're driving, let's say you're driving a vehicle, you have to stay awake, right? Have to stay awake. So I have a lot of practice in that, where I'm tired and I'm driving, I just have to, you know, find a way to shake, you know, stay awake, without drinking coffee. So again, we're just emphasizing this new new dispensation here. We're emphasizing the appropriate timing of it. We're emphasizing that now we need to stay in fashion, and non-dual, abiding non-dual awareness is the new fashion. It's the new spiritual fashion, actually. The previous dispensation was to catch a glimpse of it and long for it, you know, to long for it, to try and, what would you say, to look at it like a distant goal and say, oh, someday I just want to get there, and try to make you feel good about that. That's the old dispensation. That's passé now. We're in hardball situation right now with this with the takeover of this world. So we're in a situation now. We're going to abide in it 100% all the time. This is the new dispensation. The old one we have to part ways with. It started out long ago as a faint light at the end of a tunnel. And then at some point we looked and we said, wow, someday we hope we can reach this light. It looks like it's possible eventually, but you know, it's a long ways off. Now we're actually stepping out into the light, stepping out from the tunnel, stepping out into the light, saying goodbye tunnel. So you might say this is the real age of enlightenment right now, starting now, this new dispensation. The age of non-dual abidance. The age of non-dual abidance. There is no finish line. There's no race. There's no contest. There's no winning. There's no losing. So we are continuing to push for this age of a non-dual abidance, the age of abidance, the age of abidance. Now, before many of us have never met somebody who's actually abiding in non-dual abidance. I can't say for sure that I've ever met anyone here, you know, that was living here with a body, and I can't say that I ever have met someone. I've met those who may have glimpsed the non-dual condition and sort of extrapolated a lot from it, extrapolated a spiritual structure from it, commented on it, etc., etc. But as far as absolutely abiding in it, like the Ramana Maharshi was, no, I don't. I can't say that I've ever met anyone like that. But we do met some who have had glimpses of it, and I've had glimpses of it. So now it's going to change. We're going to meet those who are actually abiding in it. We're going to meet the Ramana Maharshi, so to speak, the Anandamaya Mahas, the Jesus Christs, the Longchenpas, the Nisargadatta Maharajas, etc., etc. We're going to actually meet them. We're actually going to sit with them. And I don't mean literally those saints necessarily, but I mean like that, those who are abiding in non-dual, the truth, non-duality, abiding in it. All the time, just abiding in it. We're going to have the opportunity, we're going to actually, it's going to happen for us. And, you know, we're just going to say, okay, we'll get used to it after a while. Say, this is where we're at now. This is the fashion of the times. And just look how much fashion has changed, like in my life. You know, it's just ridiculous. People are now, you know, they went through just massive body modification, body mutilation, and tattooing. I mean, tattooing, when I grew up, nobody had tattoos unless you were a career criminal, or you could member of a criminal biker gang, or you were a career in jail, have been in, you know, in jail, you're a criminal who've been jailed for a lot of the time, or occasionally, you know, if in the Navy, they might have an anchor or something, but that was a little different. But as far as, you know, tattoos go, it was totally unacceptable, 100% unacceptable. No, nobody in school ever even had a remote notion that they would get a tattoo. It never even arose for us. It would be the most ridiculous thing imaginable to suggest. We'd say, what am I, some kind of notorious outlaw biker criminal or something? Spending time in a maximum security facility? It had an extremely bad connotation for us, tattoos. Anyone had a tattoo, we'd absolutely steer clear of them. They're criminals, plain and simple. Low-life scum criminals. So to see people now where it's almost like majority of people have tattoos now is the most incredible shift in fashion. You could hardly, it's just mind-blowing. Mind-blowing. I mean, who are these people? And I can't get over feeling like that. To me, they're criminals, you know, because this is how we were. This is what the truth was back in the 50s, 60s, 70s in this country, around the world. The truth is that only, notorious, bad, nasty criminals had that kind of tattooing on them. For the most part, right? So yeah, we were absolutely right. You know, you don't hang around with anyone with tattoos. I mean, if you brought home someone to your parents saying, "Hey, look at my new friend," or something, and they had tattoos, you're never going to see him again. The parent says, "You, what are you doing? Are you crazy?" So this is a very, very, very strong outlook that we had, that tattoos are absolutely forbidden, and a certain sign of a notorious bad character, certain sign of bad character. So now in the world, you see, and you know, maybe in some areas, you might say half the people have them, younger people, and even older people are getting them now. And I can't help but look at them and say the bad character is still a sign of bad character, except that so many are doing it now. You know, it's almost like, wow. You almost feel like you must be wrong. Well, it can't be that many bad characters in this world, can there? Well, actually, there can. Actually, there can. But it's also become like a fashion statement. So, this is an example of how fashion trends can shift, you know, enormously. And then the piercing, all the body mutilation and piercing, and implants of all different types, and, just crazy stuff that we never even envisioned possible happening, you know, suddenly became like the norm for fashionistas. So fashion does change tremendously, and we can change our spiritual fashion tremendously too, where people, you know, back 50, 60 years ago, again, if someone asked me what ultimately is going to be your goal, I'm going to be enlightened. There's no question about it. But to say such a thing back then was like seen as sheer arrogance. I said, "Who do you think you are? You know, you're crazy. It's not possible. You're aiming way too high, way too high." What they basically said is, you might be able, you know, once in your life to catch a fleeting glimpse of something, and that would be like, you know, the highest you could possibly aspire to. But the notion that you'd be abiding in non-dual awareness, actually abiding like a Ramana Maharshi, they'd say that you're absolutely cuckoo. No chance. That you're just an arrogant dreamer. But fashions change, don't they? Pressures drive people to great efforts. And so we will be abiding in non-dual awareness. And so the vision I had will turn out to be correct. Absolutely will turn out to be correct. And that there will be those in the world in abiding in non-dual awareness, and people will be able to see that and experience it, and they'll start saying, "Wow, yeah, I can do that too. This is the new dispensation." And eventually, you know, some people will just say, "Oh, yeah, this is just the new fashion, and we're with this fashion, and this is where we're at, and it's fine. We like it. We love it. It's great." Something that would be astonishing to people in the past, thinking that, wow, no, we're just these humans full of, you know, all these terrible sins and shortcomings, and there's no way in the world we can do that. That only happens to some divine beings or something. So they didn't understand what's going on. And a lot of people say, you know, well, they say a lot of things. We could go on and on and on of what they've said. The bottom line is that we're going to do it. And this is the new fashion. This is the new dispensation. And it's necessary. It's necessary. It's a practical fashion, actually. Very practical fashion. The same way like cutting your hair in summer. Like it's blazing hot in summer. And, you know, cut your hair. Cut your hair short. So it's not all sweaty and hot. You know, so it's like a practical fashion. Or if like it's winter time, you wear warm clothing. It's just it's a practical style. So I'm trying to get everyone to look at it as a pragmatic, practical style, spiritual fashion statement. Is a non-dual awareness is the pragmatic spiritual fashion statement of the times now. It's already this true. We've already entered into this phase of the world where they're trying to generate the crisis so that they can be seen as the solution to the crisis. See, they want a hostile takeover. First, they have to generate a crisis, so we'll call out help, 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 and then they steam by and say, "Are you calling for help?" You know, it's like, "Yay, we were just like traveling through the neighborhood." You know, on our way somewhere else, and we heard these distress signals, and was that you calling for help, planet Earth? And people say, yeah, are you kidding me? Look what's happened. It's just absolutely terrible. Everything's collapsed. And they say, wow, yeah, that's shocking. How in the world did that happen? I mean, you must have really mismanaged everything here. That's terrible. Well, I'll tell you what, he says, you guys have messed things up so bad, I don't know if we can even help you out at all. I don't know if we want to help you out, you know. And so they play this game like, yeah, we're just passing through. It was just your blind, incredible, great luck. We happen to be passing through. And lucky for you, but we're not sure we can help you. But they say, no, we've got to help you. What do you, don't leave. You got to help us. Please. We'll do anything you ask of us. You just tell us what to do. We'll do it. We promise. We'll do whatever you say. And then they say, well... Well, you sound like you have promise and potential here, you know, and we hate to pass up anyone who has this kind of potential and willingness to be humble and follow our advice. You know, so we're gonna, you know what, we're gonna do something that we didn't expect we'd ever do, but we're gonna sort of delay our mission that we were going somewhere else, and we're actually gonna stay here for a while and help you out of the goodness of our hearts, the compassion, and we're going to don't worry, we'll just as long as you do exactly what we say. We'll be able to fix the situation. It's a very tough situation. It's very terrible. I'm telling you, you better do exactly what we say for as long as possible. Otherwise, you're never going to recover from this. So, and people say, okay, we'll make a deal. Where do we sign? Okay, all of this is set up in advance. They didn't just happen to be cruising by. They have been working on this blueprint for a long time, intentionally subverting this culture, this world, to bring about the very crisis that they then have the remedy for. And they're playing hard to get, and just, you know, all this whole act that they'll put on is in order to get us to sign on the dotted line and insist that we will do whatever they say, no matter what they tell us to do, we're going to do it. And then they say, okay, now, you know, this may seem harsh, but you need to get rid of these people here. They're part of the troublemakers. And in fact, they're incorrigible troublemakers. So, unfortunately, they have to be removed. And the people say, okay, whatever you say, you know. And step by step, you have this, you know, despotic, horrible despotic regime take over. And everybody's going along with it, saying, wow, we got to go along with this, you know, solve this terrible problem that we're so terrible. How did we get in such a mess? Everybody was so confused. How did we get in this mess? Not realizing that it was all orchestrated. It was very intentionally orchestrated by this cosmic corporate culture, very slyly. Like Herod Antipas, Jesus called him that sly fox. That sly fox. Gonna stay away from that sly fox. Well, the ETs are very sly foxes indeed. But not so sly if you know what to have been looking for, you would have seen it. You would have seen it all along. They know how to manipulate human psychology, human emotions, our arrogance. They know how to flatter us. They know how to scare us. They know all this, how to manipulate us in all sorts of ways. So this is, you know, this is the fashion of the times in the world. So we need a spiritual fashion that counters that, that helps us out with this, just for practical reasons, right? If it's cold, we need to put on a coat. You know, sort of like, wow, it's really cold here in this world. I need to abide in non-dual awareness, which is very spiritually warm. It's a very spiritually peaceful. You know, the world is so very spiritually chaotic right now. So I need spiritual peace. It's just obvious. Put on the code of spiritual peace. It's just an essential, pragmatic, indispensable. You don't go out in freezing winter with no jacket and a t-shirt. You know, that's just stupid. So, I mean, being stupid, I mean, I know VTs are telling us we need to be stupid, but maybe they're the ones that are being stupid in the first place. And we certainly see that's the case. I mean, and their remedies are not the remedies that really work. We realize that we need a remedy that actually works instead of following the Pied Piper like lemmings to our deaths, to our enslavement. So we'll keep working on this, we'll keep normalizing it, and I'll keep pushing on this. It has to be somehow, we have to start making some breakthroughs of normalcy, and there has to be some sort of mindset that clicks into place. And of course, those who say, why are you doing this? There's nothing wrong. Those are just trying to, you know, convince us not to. They're playing along with the ETs. The ETs tell them, hey, we don't want anybody messing up our plans. They might say, well, what about these people that are enlightened? They say, and the ETs will say, well, now, well, you know what? They're attracting all this attention. They're messing up our plans. They don't really know what to do. They're just indulging themselves, you know, instead of working hard to solve the problems of the world, they're just indulging themselves in trance states. And that's really, we don't want that at all. You know, so people say, oh, you know, you shouldn't be doing that. So you get this, you know, backlash that the and we have to say, well, you can't always control fashion. This is just the proper response to the times. That's all. That we've been conned by the ETs here. And duped by them, very cleverly duped. And we've tried to sign our future away to them. And we think we're somehow bound by this agreement, and that we'll have suffer guilt if we drop it, you know, and all this stuff. So we'll see how it goes. I have to keep working at this. We all have to keep working at this and say, yeah, this is going to be what's happening. This is what's now happening spiritually on this planet. The ETs will claim that they're what's happening spiritually. And we say, well, you know, it's kind of like the situation where in England you had the rockers and the mods, you know, and there's two different fashion statements and they didn't really agree with one another. And that's part of the deal, you know. We might say, are you still following those nasty ETs and their low spiritual expectations? Wow. You know, that's not very smart. Maybe you need to get a little nudge. You know, I remember like when people started growing long hair, the Beatles came along. Before that, nobody had long hair. Nobody. Nobody in school. We didn't have long hair then. We had short hair. Nice corporate haircuts, and the Beatles came, you know, they're shaking their head, and and they had this long hair, and their eyes, the hair was in their eyes. There's a whole thing, get the hair down here, we gotta get the hair down in our eyes, And so some, and then like some guys would start growing their hair long. And we all look at them like, well, that's weird. What a weirdo, you know. But what happened was, you know, the guys all would laugh and poke fun at the guy. Like, it might be one or two guys growing long hair, and they'd laugh and like, well, you're crazy. What are you doing that for? You know, get out of here. But the fact was that all the girls would swarm around these guys with long hair, like look like the Beatles. It was amazing what happened. And we had this guy who was a complete social incompetent, basically. And it was actually a friend of mine. And he was one of the first that grew his hair long. And he actually had these older sisters that were very influential over him. And they convinced him that this is what's cool, this is what's hip, we want you to grow your hair long. So he started growing his hair long, and he ended up with this beetle cut, you know. And he went from being just a clumsy, awkward outcast that the girls paid no attention to they were like swarming around him. He'd have a group of 10 girls around him, like laughing and talking, and because they kind of thought that they were hanging out with someone that was Beatle-ish, you know. That's like as close as they could get to the Beatles. They say, well, at least I'm hanging out with somebody that kind of looks like the Beatle-ish. You know, they were obsessed with the Beatles. Absolutely obsessed. And the rest of us were like, what? That guy? Look at all the tension. The girls think that he's the greatest thing since sliced bread. Like he's like some super hip person. And we kind of looked at each other and said, whoa, what is going on here? And eventually the pressure was so much that basically you become an outcast socially, because the girls sort of run society, and the whole social scene is run by females. Females for sure. And you like, if you wanted to ask them for a date or a dance or anything, there's no way they'd say yes unless you had long hair. There's no way. You didn't even have a chance. So more and more guys started growing their hair long. And before too long, a lot of guys had long hair. If you wanted to even be seen as with the times at all, you had to have your beetle hair. So it shows you how you go. A fashion first starts out and it's like, people say, oh, that's nuts. And then later on, everybody's doing it. But in this case, as in all fashion in the world, worldly fashion, the women, the girls, the young girls, they drive the fashion, you know, because they're the ones who go gaga about, you know, oh, that is so cool. This is like this is just totally hip, and everything else is just like completely ugly and ridiculous. And they look at you like you're like, laugh at you, giggle, and go out past, giggle, like, look at that idiot. Can you believe, you know, this is the pressure that guys are under. It's unbelievable pressure. I was just, you know, you just wear, I just get thrift store clothes. I just wore thrift store clothes or hand-me-downs, stuff that, you know, had been in fashion 10 years ago or something. And, you know, no big deal to me at all. And when you walk along the street, go into school, and there's a group of cluster of girls, they all cluster together, and they look at you or something like that, and they'd like snickering and laughing and giggling, looking at that, like, look at that idiot. You know, can you believe how they're dressed? This is like so pathetic. What an utter wimp. You know, and it just like crush you. You just feel like you're so stupid and clumsy and dumb and unsophisticated. You know, just devastating. So guys tend to go along with what the fashion that the girls think is really hip and cool. Whatever it is. Whatever it is. It's always the way. It's always the way. And I tried to bring about a counterculture to that. It wasn't successful. Still isn't successful. Still working, you know, almost 50 years later. 50. You can call it that much, 50 years later. Still working on a counterculture to counter that sort of pressure in the world, which really pressures us into stuff we don't want to do, actually. Big time. Because the flesh lusts after the flesh, okay? And arrogance is always lusting after arrogance. And so this pressure, social pressure that's brought to bear upon everyone in this world is pressuring us in ways that are very miserable for us. And ultimately, that whole scene became extraordinarily miserable for me. Horrible, horrible, terrible road to go down. And I didn't have any sisters to counteract that. If you could have some sisters, older sisters, who just said, "Don't worry, those people are trying to be hip. What idiots they are! You know, they're just insecure fools. Don't worry, you just look the way you want to look. That's perfectly fine." You know, didn't have any of that kind of reassurance. So I don't know many guys who did, but. Amazing the pressure that we get put under. So we have to somehow have the courage to do this without the backing of all this, the flesh, you know, without the backing of the flesh here in this world and all the laughing that they, you know, scorn, laughing, ostracism, looking at you like you're, you know, like, pfft. The looks they can give is just like, wow. You know, what's the matter with you? I mean, you know, that's sad. You know, it's pity. It's like, wow, that's pitiful. It's really pitiful. I get that when I use my phone, my old cell phone. You know, people just like, really? Are you kidding me? Wow, that's sad. I mean, what's wrong with this guy? You know, it's good pressure to try to withstand. Trying to withstand the pressure is very good practice like that. But ultimately, this non-dual, we have someone, we have to get going so we can withstand the pressure, you know, of that. That people will pressure us to say, wow, what do you think you're doing? So hopefully Jesus can help us with that. And it seems like Jesus is very out of style right now. You know, but it's time for Jesus to come back in style. Time for Jesus to get back in style here. So maybe we can lead that stylistic movement. Although I've never been one who was able to lead a style, fashion statement sort of thing. I've been able to go along with some, but. I've tried, but it just doesn't go anywhere, you know. But maybe this will. Maybe this will go somewhere, and maybe Jesus will help out actually. But this is an essential style. This is a style that is essential. It's not optional, actually. It's very essential. And I just remember how many styles I've been through. So many. I remember the serape style. And the Huaracha sandals. The sandals made out of old tires. I had that. We'd wear that. Wear these kind of shorts, and then we'd wear this poncho, a serape. Heavy kind of wool poncho sort of thing from Mexico. Yeah, that's what we'd wear. This was the Mexican style. South American, Latin American, Mexican style. You were a person of the people then, and a person of the people style. And then you went, flip from that to other styles, and then spandex came along, spandex style. So many different styles. It's just amazing how many styles. Of course, we went through the bell-bottom style, absolutely. Had the navy bell-bottoms from you get to go to the thrift store and get those bell-bottoms from Navy Reserve, you know, the Navy Surplus. Blue bell-bottoms, all sorts of bell-bottoms. Embroidery style, and... Peasant blouse, peasant shirt style. It was all these different styles of the people. You know, you're one of the people. One of the Indian style. Oh yeah, absolutely. We went through that. Used to wear moccasins to school. You know, either low or high moccasins to school. Leather moccasins like the Indians. Leather headband, beads, necklace beads, and all that kind of stuff. Some people wore leather pants. You know, the Indian style was very, very popular for a while. identifying with, of course, oppressed peoples, as young people tend to feel oppressed. So you might call this the non-dual, the absolute style that you're wearing. You're wearing spaciousness. Your clothing is spaciousness. Your style is pure spaciousness. It's a spiritual style. And we've gone through spiritual styles too, haven't we? Absolutely we have. Absolutely. And so it's time now for abidance, the abidance style. Absolutely, it's time. It's time. It's time for a new style to be here. Be here now. The be here now style. The be here now style. Yeah, this is the be here now style. Or the now style. This is just the now style. So I could say, well, I've always been a stylist to a certain extent, you know, and a little bit go along with this, go along with that. So, you know, it's now, I'm going along with the be here now style. The be here now style. All right, very great. Managing to power through this is very difficult. Where are we at? Well, I'm an hour and a half. Be here now style. Okay.